now, we're going to talk about cognitive behavioural therapy, or CBT. Put most simply, cognitive behavioural therapy differs from behavioural therapy in its emphasis on the importance of an individual's cognitions or thoughts. The key strategies involved in cognitive behavioural therapy are: explain the rationale for the importance of thoughts, their relationship with feelings and behaviours; identify unhelpful thoughts; challenge unhelpful thoughts; cognitive restructuring, where appropriate, replace unhelpful thoughts with more realistic thoughts. Of these strategies, the first one, explaining the rationale for the importance of thoughts, is arguably the most important. I guess the reason this strategy is so important is that if the rationale is not done well with clients, they are unlikely to engage in any of the other strategies. The model that underpins the cognitive element of cognitive behavioural therapy is the ABC model. A stands for activating event, B stands for your beliefs or thoughts about that event, and C stands for consequences, that is, your emotional, physiological, and behavioural consequences. I'm going to work through an example exactly the same way that I would with a client. Let's say that the activating event, or the thing that has happened, is that our partner is 1.5 hours late home from work. They're not usually late, and there's been no phone call. Now, what's one way of making sense of this event, of explaining it to yourself or thinking about it in your own head? It doesn't have to be what you would necessarily think. It's just one way of explaining why the partner is late home. For example, you might think to yourself that he or she may have had a busy day at work, that they've been held up at work. If this is what you genuinely believe, what's your emotional consequence going to be? It's unlikely that you will feel worried. You might feel a little bit annoyed, but you probably won't experience any physiological consequences. Would there be any behavioural consequences? You might try to ring them to get in contact, but that's probably about it. Another, different way of explaining this event to yourself is that you think to yourself that your partner has had a car accident on their way home from work. Now, if you genuinely believe that this is the reason that your partner is late, a likely emotional consequence is that you will be worried. In terms of physiological consequences, your heart rate might go up. In terms of behavioural consequences, you might try calling your partner. You might even try calling the nearest hospital. Let's look at a third way of making sense of this event. What about if you think to yourself that your partner is cheating on you? If you genuinely believe that the reason that your partner is late home is that they're cheating on you, you might feel angry and upset. These are some likely emotional consequences. Would there be any physiological consequences? Your heart might start to race. You may feel short of breath or a bit shaky. What about behavioural consequences? Is there anything that you would do? I've had people, clients and students alike, tell me a whole range of different behaviours they think they might engage in. For example, I've had people say that they'd get on Tinder and hook up with somebody else, and that they'd destroy their partner's belongings. One very specific example was when a client told me that she would cut all the crotches out of her husband's expensive suit pants. The point that I need to make, whether I'm explaining this ABC example to you or to clients, is that for one activating event, our partner being 1.5 hours late home from work, we have easily generated three different ways of thinking about it. And depending on how we think about it or make sense of the activating event, we end up with different sets of emotional, physiological, and behavioural consequences. What this tells us is it's not so much what happens to us in our lives that is important. From a cognitive perspective, what is critical is how we make sense of or think about the things that happen to us in our lives. Providing a good and clear rationale about the importance of thoughts is the linchpin of cognitive behavioural therapy. Once we've done this, we can ask clients to start keeping track of or catching the thoughts that they have when their mood is low, anxious, angry, or whatever negative emotion they are feeling, so that they can identify their unhelpful thoughts. Then we teach them about cognitive restructuring. Cognitive restructuring involves having people look at the evidence for and against the thoughts that are causing them to feel distressed. It is not about thinking positively per se, but rather about learning to realistically evaluate the likelihood that unhelpful thoughts are accurate.